Well, it's a privilege, my brothers and sisters, to be back on the firing line with you. And my only challenge is I think I ate too much. But if you'll pardon that, we'll try and overcome and get on with the program today. Our subject for this hour and half or whatever it is, when do we finish? 3 o'clock. Hour and a half is the creations of God, worlds without number. And we use as a theme the Lord's statement to Moses, chapter 1, where he declares that through his only begotten Son, he has created worlds without number. Let me just begin by putting this in proper context. One important revelation given to us as Latter-day Saints in this dispensation is the simple statement that the elements are eternal. Another one is that intelligence, the primal intelligence of man, is eternal. That the ego, the will of the individual is eternal. And that therefore matter is as old as God. Now that's quite contrary to the theology of the Christian world that believes that this earth was created in 7 days out of nothing. And that while God creates man, that the initial life of man is a creation of God and a product of God. And that is not true. The elements are eternal. Intelligence, the light of truth, the basic life and entity of life and ego within man, is as old as God. And so we put this in this particular context. You may not be able to understand this one as fully now as maybe a few minutes later, but let me put it into the hopper now. The prophet Joseph Smith makes this statement: the world and the earth are not synonymous terms. The world is the human family. There's going to be an end of the world in the sense of the human order of things. This earth was organized or formed out of other planets, which were broken up and remodeled and made into the one on which we now live. I wondered about that statement and gone back and done the research on that, and there's no question but what the prophet taught that. And pardon? Well, this one is quoted from the compendium published by Franklin D. Richards and James A. Little, compendium page 287. It's the 1882 edition of the compendium. But that of itself then says several things. If the elements are eternal, then they've gone through an endless series of something. They should have the evidences of eternity built within them. If this earth was formed from fragments of other worlds, then you can't say that the creation that we read of in the scripture is the origin of evidences of life on this earth. You can't say that. The story is told that President Grant, for example, one time was having dinner with a family, and for dessert they had a lovely fruit cake. And during the course of dessert, they were talking about the creation. And the subject came up that this earth then was only so many thousand years old. And that this is contradictory because the elements indicate to the contrary. So President Grant took a nut out of the fruitcake and held it up and says, "Sister," addressing the lady of the house, "when did you bake this cake?" She says, "I did it last week." You mean, therefore, to tell me that this nut is 1 week old? Of course not. I bought it at the grocery store. And how old it is, I don't know, see. Well, similarly, you're not dealing in the story of creation with elements that began at the time of creation. You're dealing with the Lord saying, as he does in the book of Abraham, here is matter. Let's take of this matter, and we'll organize the earth on the earth whereon these may dwell. See? It's an organizational process, and you're organizing out of elements that are eternal in nature, and that goes way, way back without the beginning. And then more immediately, you're dealing with fragments of former systems. And some people may say, well, they just put them all together and scrambled it like those beautiful eggs we had this morning. And that's not necessarily the case either. The Lord, by the power of His Spirit, can do things intricately and bring things together with intricate and precise intent and purpose and results. He can do that. And so we're not talking about that. There's some unknowns, many unknowns in the creation. But we do have some very basic substantive things that we can talk about. Now, the book of Abraham makes some interesting contributions, particularly as it sets the stage. See, in the book of Abraham, the creation of the earth is put in the context of the Kolob system. Now, that's point one. It's put in the context of the Kolob system. And you have to see this earth in the context of the whole revelation of the Lord to Abraham of the Kolob order of things. And all the evidence would suggest that that Kolob system would be our galaxy, what we would call the Milky Way galaxy. And so you're dealing with that kind of thing then in the Abraham account. Now, in this little unit that we call facsimile, number two, let me turn over to there with you. A lot of times we don't bother to read these things. But in facsimile number two, figure one, it signifies then, signifying the first creation nearest to the celestial or the residence of God. Now note it's nearest. And what nearest means in eternity may not be geographical so much as organizational. Nearest then means direct contact. It's in direct contact as the great governing orb of this system that is what we call the Kolob system. It's in direct contact and gets its law directly from the Father, see, and from the residence there, the place where God dwells. He says, first in government, the last pertaining to the measurement of time. The measurement according to celestial time, which celestial time signifies one day, is a cubit. And that's an interesting thing because you're talking about things in the measurement of distance as well as time. It's got a dimension there that we're going to have to work on a little more to really see and maybe have a little more information and insight before we can really draw a final conclusion on that point. He says, one day in Kolob is equal to 1,000 years according to the measurement of this earth, which is called in the Egyptian Ja'oel. And then figure number two stands next to Kolob. And you can follow the figures through here over on the facsimile. Stands next to Kolob, called in the Egyptian Oliblish, which is the next grand governing creation near to the celestial or the place where God dwells, holding the key of power also pertaining to other planets, as revealed from God to Abraham, as also as Abraham offered sacrifice upon an altar which he had built unto the Lord. The third one is made to represent God sitting upon his throne, clothed with power and authority, with the crown of eternal light upon his head, representing also the grand keywords of the holy priesthood, as revealed to Adam and in the Garden of Eden, as also to Seth, Noah, Melchizedek, Abraham, and all to whom the priesthood was revealed. Now, you're putting the whole creation story in the context of the temple here. The grand keywords of the priesthood, see, and revealing them in the house of the Lord. And it's interesting then that the Lord doesn't make them separate. Rather, instead, the whole creation program then is dovetailed in, tied in, and an expression of God and of His holy priesthood and of the great keywords of priesthood, and particularly the things that are revealed in the temple, as it indicates a little later down in this same page. Number four, answers to the Hebrew word rakinyang, signifying expanse or the firmament in the heavens, also a numerical figure in Egyptian signifying 1,000. Answers to the measurement of time of Oliblish, which is equal with Kolob in its revolutions and in its measurement of time. Now he's talking about the great orbs that govern the Kolob system. And then he goes on and says, it's called in the Egyptian number five, and it's Ganondosh. This is one of the governing planets also. And there's some important ideas here I'd like to have you be sure that you see. And it's said by the Egyptians to be the sun and to borrow its light from Kolob through the medium of Kevanras, which is the great grand key. A lot of people have the idea that the sun just kind of got warmed up somewhere out there, and it's gradually burning down. Now, that's not the book of Abraham, I think. Rather, instead, there is a great cycle of light. Let me just get the statement here out of my book on God, man, and the universe to show you what I mean. There's a great cycle of light. And it centers in Kolob, and it's extended then to other major bodies and on down through to the sun. And the sun then receives energy and light then from the higher source. And then there's a pickup on that, a cycle back. There's that kind of a picture. For instance, in the Prophet Yoda Smith's Egyptian alphabet and grammar, and this, as I said this morning, I think, is a thing that he worked on and devised by and means of the Urim and Thummim and so forth in his work on the Book of Abraham to provide himself with a key to the language. It would be the Adamic language, really, because that was the language that we're primarily dealing with. Abraham uses the Egyptian hieroglyphics and so forth. He does that, but it all also centers back. He had the records that go back to the fathers. For example, here in the book of Abraham, chapter 1, verse 31, he says, "But the records of the fathers, even the patriarchs, concerning the right of priesthood, the Lord my God preserved in mine own hands. Therefore, a knowledge of the beginning of the creation, and also of the planets and of the stars, as they were made known unto the fathers." Now, this is something prior to Abraham. And the book and the Egyptian alphabet and grammar indicates that Methuselah was the first to discover Kolob. See, and so as you see this fuller picture then, that apparently the prophet understood, then it's something beyond what we've got in the written record itself. He says, "As they were made known to the fathers, have I kept even unto this day, and I shall endeavor to write some of these things upon this record for the benefit of my posterity that shall come after me." And that's an interesting, tantalizing statement there, because he never does do that in the book of Abraham as we now have it. He ends up instead, the fifth chapter of Abraham, with the end of the creation. And that's not consistent either with the facts of history that we know. We know that when they got the papyri from which the book of Abraham was translated, there were two major historical sources. One was the book of Joseph, the patriarch Joseph was sold into Egypt, and the other was Abraham. And Oliver Cowdery writes, and just how many large volumes of this contains, we don't know, see. And then in the spring of 1842, as editor of the Times and Seasons, Joseph then publishes that part of the book of Abraham that we now have. And then due to the press of circumstances and difficulties in his life, then he surrendered the editorship of the Times and Seasons to John Taylor. Just about the time the former subscriptions that everyone had been asked to make because they were going to get the book of Abraham, you know. That former subscription then was about ready to run out. And so President John Taylor then writes a little note in the Times and Seasons and says, hey, your subscriptions are about ready to run out. And we'd like to have you renew them. I've talked with the prophet Joseph. He wants to give us more of the book of Abraham as soon as he can. Get your subscriptions in so that you'll be sure and get that. And that was never forthcoming. You see that? And Abraham he never fulfills this promise on that portion of the book of Abraham that we now have. Where he says, I've got all this from the ancient fathers. I've got it from what Methuselah got and all that. And I'm going to write some of this thing on my record for the benefit of my posterity, see. He's making a family record. And he never does do that. Instead, what we get is his own personal revelation on the great Kolob system and then the story of the creation, and then it ends there. You see that? So the evidence indicates that there was much more of the book of Abraham that could have been given had the prophet had the time. And I just wish the brethren in that day, instead of hassling him, would have just settled in and said, Joseph, you get to work on that and we'll take care of chopping your wood. We'll do all these menial tasks. We just want you to get time and get that material out for our benefit, see? And it never did happen. It just never did happen. And it's one of those sad episodes, I believe, really, in our history that we don't have all of it. But in the Egyptian alphabet and grammar, which the prophet devised, you find this statement. The highest degree of light, because its component parts are light. And that's a kind of an interesting one all of itself. The governing principles of light, because God has said, let this be the center for light, and let there be bounds that it may not pass. Now, you're talking about an organizer. You're talking about some kind of device and means for the control of light in the Kolob system itself. He hath set a cloud round about the heavens, and the light of the grand governing of 15 fixed stars center there. There it is drawn from the heavenly bodies, according to the decrees that God hath set. As the bounds of the ocean, that it should not pass over the flood, so God has set the bounds of light, lest it pass over and consume the planets. Ever hear anything about that in the whole environmental situation today? Is in it? Well, Joseph Smith was up on that in his day, you know. One of the men who was very close to the prophet was in the translation of the book of Abraham was William W. Phelps, probably the closest to the prophet of any of the brethren. Wilford would have helped on some things, but Phelps was probably the closest to the prophet in the actual work of creation. And Phelps had a theological bent to his mind and his thinking and his interest. He picked up on things like that. Now later, as Phelps came out to the West, he published an almanac, and like Ben Franklin of earlier years, he filled the almanac up with interesting statements. Honesty is the best policy, you know, as if honesty is a policy. But things like that, as Ben Franklin, instead of putting things like that in the picture, though, Phelps composed poetry. And the thing he drew on was his understanding of materials in the Abraham material or manuscript, if I can put it that way. Let me read you one. Up in the heavens above, where the life-giving power is spread undivided, there is a fountain of love, where the priesthood in virtue as head hath presided over planets and stars and their beings forever. Here in those mansions so bright, where the footsteps of men never tread in probation, there is a fountain of light, where true wisdom and knowledge are spread in rotation to the millions of worlds and their people forever. You pick that one up. Right in the center of this is a throne where our Father sits crowned with his neighbors. Now, that's a great one, see. We expect that we're going to be exalted if we live faithfully and live on this earth. We'll have our own creations and so forth, and our neighbors next door are going to have theirs, and we expect to have a social life with them, as the prophet says in the Doctrine and Covenants. That same sociality that exists among us here will exist among us there, except it'll be coupled with eternal glory, which glory we do not now enjoy. That's how he puts it, see. But God sits right in the center of this. It's a throne where the Father sits crowned with his neighbors. Here is the spirit of bliss, which the wisdom of man never found by his labors, even light, which is life to creations forever. And that's a choice, little one. See, and it comes out of Phelps' intimate relationship with Joseph Smith in the translation of the Book of Abraham. And the idea then is, to come back here to point figure number five, that there is an organization of light. There's a light cycle, if I can put it that way. Talks about Cave Anrash, which is the grand key, or in other words, the governing power which governs 15 other fixed stars. Also, Flossisi, or the moon, the earth, and the sun in their annual revolutions. This planet receives its power through the medium of Kyphosis, or Hakoko beam, and the stars represented in number 22 and 3 receive light from the revolutions of Kolob. You see that picture there? Now, Joseph Smith translated this in the days of the Newtonian concept of the universe. And Newton he's justly classified and recognized as maybe the greatest scientific mind of all time, and a tremendous individual. Interestingly, he wrote more on theology than he did on science. And the world has never done anything about that. I found mention made of a book that was published, written by Newton, published 3 years after his death, on the prophecies of Daniel and John the Revelator. And so I went to work and got myself a copy of it. A fellow had found it in the archives back in Washington and got permission to make a photocopy of it. And the copy that he used as the base copy was Thomas Jefferson's copy of Newton's work. And it is a classic work. He deals with the prophetic picture, and he talks about the need for there to be a restoration of the gospel. And he quotes Daniel 2 and 44, days of these kings shall the God of heaven set up a kingdom. And he quotes Revelation 14, 6 and 7, the angel flying through the midst of heaven. And he talks about the need for a new dispensation of the gospel and for the building of Zion, and all of that by Newton. It's a fascinating thing to read through there. You're dealing with the work of a man who is one of the great minds of the earth, who gets a hold of the book of Daniel, believes it implicitly, and the book of Revelation, and gives his version of it from his standpoint. And it's a classic document. I mean, we know a lot more by Revelation in our day than he knew. But considering the day and the time and the information they had available at the time, it is a real, genuinely classic document worth reading. But we're dealing, to get back to the basic thing, we're dealing now with the Newtonian concept of the universe. And the Newtonian concept was that of a fixed universe, as they call it. It's the fixed universe. It's nothing's really moving, the sun and the earth and the planets, but the whole universe is just out there. Now, since then we've moved away from that to the revolving thing. And you've got the Big Bang Theory, and they're still in process of trying to work a lot of things through. When eventually they finally come back to the prophet Joseph Smith and see as he put it, then I think we'll finally get the picture correctly. It puts God into the picture and puts the system then, not just of the galaxy out here as a bunch of stars and planets and orbs and comets and you name it, but actually as a system where there is central power, direction, intelligence, and where light then is extended from one orb to another, and where there are bounds and limits set so that it doesn't consume, but rather provides the right degree of radiance and life. See, that's the picture of things that we get from the book of Abraham. And we haven't really mined that yet as a church and as a people to the extent that we ought. Now, let's look, for example, at things as the various prophets in the prolegate Christ saw them, or at least as they have left as a record of what they knew and what they understood. And keep in mind that I suspect this is only partial, even with Moses. What did Moses talk with the Lord about for 40 days? What did he say? What was said back and forth? What questions did he ask? He says, I've got a lot more to ask of him, and I'm going to do some inquiring. What's more is said? What did Enoch really know and understand? See, what did Abraham really know? What's in the rest of the book of Abraham that we don't have? See, what's there? I'll tell you one thing that was there. Here in the teachings, page 190, you have this statement, and note how it's worded, and you see if you can find it in the prolegate Christ. It says this, everlasting covenant was made between three personages before the organization of this earth, and relates to their dispensation of things to men on the earth. These personages, according to Abraham's record. Now, where do you find this in Abraham? These personages, according to Abraham's record, are called God the First, the Creator, God the Second, the Redeemer, and God the Third, the Witness or Testator. Now, there's no such statement in the book of Abraham, but he got it from those materials. See, we're dealing with a situation where Joseph had a lot more and probably translated much more, but didn't get it put down and published. And we only have a partial record. We talk about the sealed portion of the Book of Mormon and other things that are yet to come forth. And my hope and desire is that we get the rest of the book of Abraham and the, I'm sure, great and classic document of Joseph who was sold into Egypt, the two of which would make volumes if we had them, see. Now, whether we're worthy of it, I suspect we've been given about as much as we're worthy of receiving. But getting back to Enoch now. Now, Methuselah being the first to discover Kolob, I'm sure then that Enoch had a knowledge then in relation to the great stellar system. In Moses chapter 7, verse 30 and 31, let's see some of the gems that have been left there that may be helpful to us. Here, for example, the record says this. Were it possible that man could number the particles of the earth, yea, millions of earths like this, it would not be a beginning of the number of thy creations. How many particles are there in this earth? Go down and start with the nearest beach and count them all. It wouldn't be a beginning to the number of thy creations. And he says, thy curtains are stretched out still, and yet thou art there, and thy bosom is there, and also thou art just, and thou art merciful and kind forever. And as we read this morning, and thou hast taken Zion to thine own bosom from all thy creations, from all eternity to all eternity. And let me just pause on that statement. We'll get into a discussion of what I would call a finite eternity. That's contradictory in a way, but it gets over the idea. But another use of the word eternity is that which is used here. From all eternity to all eternity. According to the prophet Joseph Smith in the Lectures on Faith, that means from the endless past to this point as at present time, that's all eternity to all eternity is from this point now on to the endless future, see? It's talking about the broad sweep with the particular person at the time and at the moment in the middle, from all eternity to all eternity. And naught but peace, justice, and truth is the habitation of thy throne, and mercy shall go before thy face and hath no end. How is it that thou canst weep? Now, another statement, for example, and that's in chapter 7, verse 36, where the Lord comes back and says, "Wherefore I can stretch forth mine hands and hold all the creations which I have made, and my eye can pierce them also. And among all the workmanship of mine hands, there has not been so great wickedness as among thy brethren." Now this earth has been reduced to lower dregs of life than any other earth in the creations of Christ. And the experience that's gone on in this earth then has been the experience of the depths. Two ways. Keep in mind to begin with, like the Lord says here in section 88, verse 25, "The earth abideth the law of the celestial kingdom, for it filleth measure of its creation and transgresses not the law." So the earth is fulfilling the measure of its creation, and it's abiding the law of the celestial kingdom. And it's a living organism. Enoch heard it cry out and say, "Lord, I'm tired of the filth that's going on, the stomping and the wiggling and the junk that's going on in the name of music and in the name of entertainment. I'm just tired of that. When am I going to get cleansed?" See? But the earth then is living the celestial law. Then it's been reduced then to the lowest kind of experience in two ways. One, by the corruption that's been on the earth. And we see that then manifest in the period just before the flood. And I've personally heard a prophet of God say that we are in that same general state today. That we have arrived. That the condition of this earth is equivalent in corruption and perversion to that which prevailed before the flood, see? And so we're living in the dregs of that, see? Now the second reason or means by which things have been reduced centers in Gethsemane. And it centers in the experience of Christ. And He, through the suffering that He went for us, descended below all things, below all things, and He experienced in the atonement the depths greater than has been experienced by any form of life on all of His creations. He went to the depths. Now the corruption that we've got here, then that's another ballgame. But Jesus descended below all things, and He had the capacity, and that's why this thing touches me so. He had the capacity, He being God, and He having what I would call an indwelling relationship with past, present, and future. He had an affinity with, he empathized with, on a spiritual plane, so that He actually could feel my sins. And He could feel your sins, literally feel them, and in the experience of the aggregate experience then He went clear down to the depths. He descended below all things that He might comprehend all things, past, present, and future. He comprehended them by the fact that He was God, not just a sinless sacrifice. He made an infinite sacrifice, not just a sinless one, an infinite one. And that infinite sacrifice by the powers that were in Him and which He could utilize in experiencing the darkness of all His creations meant that my sins then took Him down partway into the depths of darkness. And that's true of all of us, see. And when we begin to see and to feel the character of that sacrifice and begin to understand what it means, then it's on that basis you can come
a broken heart, a contrite spirit. And you begin to see that, and you begin to feel that. And now that was experienced on this earth. It's the redemptive earth, see? And meantime then, the corruption on this earth then was also greater than anything else on any other world. And as that sense then, this earth eventually will reap the benefits. For example, the prophet Joseph Smith is reported to have said that the earth has descended below all things, has been degraded below anything that God has created, and as a result, that it will then be exalted in proportion to the degree it's been debased, and that the earth again will revolve in its original orbit next to Kolob and will be second in size to it. And that's a whole other ballgame that I don't know whether I dare talk about. But that is another ballgame. It will be second in authority and in power and in size to Kolob, see? So my suggestion would be that you hang on to your real estate and get an eternal claim on it. Just don't go down to the recorder's office and make sure things are squared up there, see? Okay, now Enoch then sees these pictures, and this is a part of his contribution to our understanding of our earth and of our universe and of where we are. And we need to begin to see that more fully. We just get fed so much of the evolutionary thing and of all of that, that becomes the framework of our thinking, and we buy all that junk. We buy all of that, and it just simply is not consistent. There's a whole new way to put together the facts of science, to make them compatible, and to put them into the context of God's creations. Now let's turn to the book of Abraham for a minute. Abraham, for example, begins his whole account of the creation by his statement concerning the Kolob system. And this is opened to him by revelation. It says, for example, here beginning with verse 1, I, Abraham, had the Urim and Thummim, which the Lord my God had given me in Ur of the Chaldees, and I saw the stars, that they were great, and that one of them was nearest unto the throne of God. Now, nearest in the sense of this light cycle, nearest in the sense of the glory relationship, nearest in the sense of authority, nearest in the sense of controlling power. Not necessarily nearest in the sense that it's next door to it, because that would put the orb on which our Father dwells in this solar system, and I just don't believe that the Scriptures can be applied in that direction. He goes on and says, and there were many great ones which were near unto this orb called Kolob. And the Lord said unto me, these are the governing ones, and the name of the great one is Kolob, because it is near unto me, for I am the Lord thy God, and I have set this one, and here's where you get the idea of nearness and what it means, I have set this one to govern all those which belong to the same order as that upon which thou standest. And so this earth then is a part of the Kolob system, and Kolob is the great governing orb then for the total system. And the Lord said unto me by the Urim and Thummim that Kolob was after the manner of the Lord according to its times and seasons in the revolutions thereof, that one revolution was a day unto the Lord after his manner of reckoning, it being 1,000 years according to the time appointed unto that which whereon thou standest. This is the reckoning of the Lord's time according to the reckoning of Kolob. Makes you wonder where Peter gets his statement when he writes that 1,000 years with man is a day with the Lord. See, apparently he had some insight from somewhere. Goes on to say, the Lord said unto me, the planet which is the lesser light, lesser than that which is the rule of the day, even the night, the night is above or greater than that which thou standest in reckoning, in point of time, rotations, etc., etc. See? And in seeing this whole picture then Abraham sees first of all the Kolob system and has certain explanations given to him. And this then through the Urim and Thummim. And then the focus is turned now to the life elements within the Kolob system, and particularly what we would call the human life elements. He gets this explanation here, beginning with verse 18. If there be two spirits, and one shall be more intelligent than the other, yet these two spirits, notwithstanding one is more intelligent than the other, have no beginning. They existed before, they shall have no end, they shall exist after, for they are no longer eternal. And the Lord said unto me, these two facts do exist, that there are two spirits, one being more intelligent than the other, there shall be another more intelligent than they. I, the Lord thy God, and it's Jehovah who is speaking, am more intelligent than they all. I've always liked the statement of B.H. Roberts, where he says, I believe that means not that he knows more than the next guy standing to him. That's not his exact words. It's just my Southeast Idaho brogue. But it's not just that he knows more than the next person in intelligence, but that his intelligence is greater than the composite of all others of the Father's children. You see that? I am more intelligent than they all in the aggregate, not just the next person. You see that? Then he says, and the Lord thy God sent his angel to deliver thee from the hands of the priest of Elkanah, and I dwell in the midst of them all. I now therefore have come down unto thee to deliver unto thee the works of my hands, which my hands have made. And this is Jehovah that's talking about here. I've come down to deliver the words, wherein my wisdom excelleth them all. For I rule in the heavens above and in the earth beneath, in all wisdom and prudence, over all the intelligences thine eyes have seen from the beginning. I came down in the beginning in the midst of all the intelligences thou hast seen. And then Abraham makes this classic explanation in the way of summation of what he had been told and seen. Seen and told. He says, now the Lord had shown unto me, Abraham, the intelligences that were organized before the world was. I don't want to get into this because we want to talk about pre-earth life and the nature of spirits and the nature of intelligence a little later. But I would like to point this out just in passing. He's not talking here in his use of the word intelligence about primal life. If you read this carefully, the word intelligences is a synonym for spirits, organized spirits. You see that? Now Abraham, the Lord had shown unto Abraham the intelligence that were organized before the world was, and among all these there are many of the noble and great ones. And God saw these souls that they were good, and he stood in the midst of them, and he said to them, these I will make my rulers, and he stood among those that were spirits. You see that? Intelligences were organized spirits. The book of Abraham does not directly deal with primal life. It only picks the picture up at the point of spirit birth and the picture there. But it does infer, if intelligences were organized to be spirits, then it infers there was some rudimentary things from which it was organized. You see that? So indirectly then, it leads us to understand that there was something prior to the organization of intelligences. Now he goes on and says, God saw these souls that they were good, and he stood in the midst of them, and he said, these I will make my rulers, for he stood among those that were spirits. And he saw that they were good, and he said unto me, Abraham, thou art one of them. Thou wast chosen before thou wast born. So Abraham is given a knowledge and understanding of who he was, and in some measure of the role he played in pre-earth life. And then he persisted in that. And that was the part of the divine, the energy and the drive within the man, if I can put it that way, by which he reached up and became who he was. He learned who he was. And the Lord opened it to him and gave him a basis then for his faith. Now, if the Lord is no respecter of persons, let me suggest to you that through diligence and through perseverance and through really living as we ought, the Lord can do the same for us. You can know who you were in pre-earth life. You can know the role that you played in pre-earth life. You can know the scene of your existence prior to this earth. Otherwise, God is a respecter of persons. You see that? Otherwise, he is. I'll just leave it at that point. He goes on and says, there stood one among them, that is, among these noble and great ones, who was likened to God. And right after that, you put i.e. Jehovah or Jesus Christ. You see, he's talking about him. And he said unto those who were with him, we will go down, and we will take, for there is space there, and we will take of these materials, and we will make an earth whereupon these, the residue of the Father, Spirit, children, may dwell. All right, now, the creation then was carried on by whom? By Christ and the noble and great ones under the direction of the Father. You see that? And who participated in the creation? Not just Jesus, but the noble and great ones. And believe me, in that day, in the Lord's estimation, there were sisters as well as brethren involved in the creation program. It wasn't just the church order. You've got to get the holy order into operation there. And it's a cooperative program. The redemption of the human family is a cooperative program. That's what we have temples for, see? The Lord could do it all just by the wave of the hand and say, okay, let every ordinance that ought to be done and put into place. He doesn't do that. He works then and he utilizes his agency. And from the book of Abraham, it's apparent that the same kind of things happened, and the noble and great ones, and it doesn't specify anything further than that, but the noble and great ones then were involved in the creation. Now, another point, as they, from verse 25 down through to verse 28, we'll leave that for a minute. Let me just jump right down to chapter 4, verse 1, where you continue now this same theme on down. And then the Lord said, let us go down. Now, who's the us? According to the setting, it's been the noble and great ones, right? Let us go down. And they went down at the beginning, and they, that is the gods, organized and formed the heavens and the earth. Now, the book of Abraham uses the plural, the gods. And according to what has been said and the record, what the record indicates, who then were the gods? Who were they? They were the noble and great ones with Christ at their head as the only begotten. You see that? And what does that say, then, about men like Abraham? It says that they had exalted themselves by their diligence and their growth and their development to the status of gods before they came to earth. Let me read you from the prophet Joseph Smith. This is the teachings of the prophet here, beginning with page 374. He says, they found fault with Jesus Christ because he said he was the Son of God and made himself equal with God. They say of me, like they did of the apostles of old, that I must be put down. What did Jesus say? Is it not written in your law, I said ye are gods? And he's quoting here from the book of John, 10th chapter, I believe. What did Jesus say? Is it not written in your law that I said ye are gods? If he called them gods unto whom the word of God came. Now this is Jesus referring them and handling the challenge that the Jews made against him for being the Son of God. He's going back to their scriptures and said, if he called them gods unto whom the word of God came and the scriptures cannot be broken, say ye of him whom the Father hath sanctified and sent to the world, thou blasphemest, because I said, I am the Son of God. And then the prophet goes on to say, it was through him that they drank of the spiritual rock. Of course he would take the honor to himself. Jesus, if they were called gods unto whom the Word of God came, why should it be thought blasphemy that I should say that I am the Son of God? Then the prophet goes on and says this, the Scriptures are a mixture of very strange doctrines to the Christian world, who are blindly led by the blind. He says, I will refer to another Scripture. Now says God when he visited Moses in the bush, thou shalt be a God unto the children of Israel. God said again, thou shalt be a God unto Aaron, and he shall be thy spokesman. And then the prophet, quoting those two statements from Exodus, makes this commentary. He said, I believe those gods, that God reveals as gods. Case in point, Moses, Abraham, and so forth. I believe those gods, that God reveals as gods, to be sons of God, who exalt themselves to be gods, even from before the foundation of the world. Now, what did men like Moses and Abraham do? They exalted themselves to be gods, even before the foundation of the world. Now, that requires us to take another look at our concept of the plurality of gods. It requires an adjustment. The mentality exists among many of us that the only way you become a god is by being eternally married and having the powers of procreation and increase in the resurrection. That's the basic idea. If you're going to become a god, that's the way you do it. And so marriage is necessary, and godhood centers in the procreative function and power. Now, there's an element of truth there, but you need to reorient it in order to see it correctly. Godhead does not center in the procreative function. Godhead centers in the mind. Godhead's the procreative function is a subordinate thing that's given as an empowerment to those then who become gods. Now, what do we mean then by becoming gods? Well, let me go back to the rebirth process and analyze it and discuss it a little from that vantage point. The Scriptures teach that if you receive the Word of the Lord and you're renewed and regenerated by the powers of the Spirit and put off the world and put on Christ and are made a new creature in Christ by the living powers of the Spirit that we receive, we become sons and daughters of God, right? That's the basic doctrine of rebirth. It's a doctrine then of renewal through the Spirit and entering into a newness of life and thereby becoming sons and daughters of God. And you become sons and daughters by receiving the divine nature, the Spirit, the light, the truth, the intelligence, the transforming power that when you receive in fullness, is that by which you're glorified and made celestial? You see then? When you get into that mode and you move into that category and in that program, then you put off the natural man and you begin then to partake of the attributes of deity. And the powers of deity begin to center in us. And you put off the natural man and you become a son in that new realm of life. Now, the question then is this. Having become a son or a daughter, what do you then become when you grow up spiritually and are given keys of the priesthood by which you can develop those powers in other people? Then what do you become? You move from the status of children to parents. You move from the status of sons of God to the status of gods, do you not? A god is one, then, who has assimilated the divine attributes of God's glory and power, and who has the keys and the powers to develop that in other people. Now, note, for example, how the Lord puts that over here in section 132 of the Doctrine and Covenants, where you deal, then, with the subject of the plurality of gods. It talks about the righteous, then, in the day of resurrection and judgment, they shall pass by the angels and the gods, which are set there to their exaltation and glory in all things. Now, it's not talking about just having kids. The primary thing is what? Exaltation and glory in all things, as hath been sealed upon their heads. Which glory shall be the fullness, a fullness of glory, and, this is a secondary thing, and a continuation of the seeds forever. You see that? And he says, then shall they be gods, because they have no end. Now the primary factor there is the divine nature. The secondary factor is the power of increase, you see. God gives those who come up through the sanctifying processes and through the endowment processes of the gospel, he gives them, if they get the fullness, then the powers of eternal increase, by which they can beget spirit children and take those spirit children through the whole program. It's what Joseph Smith called receiving the keys of endless lives. And the term itself comes from the book of Hebrews, chapter 7. Receiving the keys of endless lives. The keys of endless lives are the keys then to do all things in from pre-earth life clear on through to where you get your spiritual. The idea of Godhead then being centered in the sanctifying processes and in glory, and then eternal increase is given to those who have achieved that exalted status. You see that? So that glory or Godhood does not center in the procreative process, as important as that is, and as sacred as that is, and as intimate as that is, see? But rather, instead, it centers in the gospel process, and then that function is given as an adjutant power by which you can then develop glory in some other people. And the way you do that is by begetting your spirit children and developing it in them, see? But the primary one is the Godhood program. Now, what the book of Abraham is saying then is that there were those pre-earth spirits, even in the first estate, who developed in the attributes of deity and the powers of deity to the degree that they not only assimilated and received, but to the degree that they had keys and powers to develop those divine attributes and powers in other people. And they were called gods. And among them there was Abraham and Moses. And we know from a report of Joseph Young, Brigham Young's oldest brother, of the prophet Joseph's teachings, that included Enoch and so forth. See? So that kind of a picture then is a thing that we really need to see. Is that clear? Now let's get back to the story a little bit here. Abraham sees also the grand council. He saw that what happened there. He, in vision as it were, sat and looked on what he and others had done in the grand council of the gods. Now we're talking about a council that the prophet Joseph indicates was held on Kolob. And where the design then was set for the creation of this earth and of other worlds. And Abraham, in his experience then, not only learned who he was, but he saw the functions of the grand council, of which he was a member in pre-earth life. And so when he writes the account of the story of the creation, then he writes it in the form of a blueprint followed by an account. Now, let me turn to the book of Abraham with you and show you what I mean by that. Let's turn over to the fourth chapter of the book of Abraham and just read a few things here in his account of the creation. Verse 11, let's start there. And the gods said, now this is Abraham's report after seeing in vision the grand council, and then seeing the creation. And so he reports first what the grand counselors did in the way of plan, and then he reports what they did in the way of action. You see that? And so it says, the God said, let us prepare the earth to bring forth grass, the herb yielding seed, the fruit
tree yielding fruit after his kind, whose seed is in itself, yieldeth its own likeness upon the earth. And it was so even as they ordered. And the gods organized the earth to bring forth grass. Now, the first statement is blueprint. Let's do it. This is what let's do, see? And then he takes that and puts that right along with a statement of what they then later did. And the gods organized the earth to bring forth grass from its own seed, and the herb to bring forth herb from its own seed, yielding seed after his kind, and the earth to bring forth the tree from its own seed, yielding fruit, whose seed could only bring forth the same in itself after his kind, and the gods saw that they were obeyed. See? So you have a blueprint plus an account. Now do the same thing, for example, with verse 20 and 21, dealing with the fifth day. It says, and the God said, let us prepare the waters to bring forth abundantly the moving creatures that have life, and the fowl, that they may fly above the earth in the open expanse of heaven. Now that is what they said in grand council. This is what they did. And the gods prepared the earth, the waters, that they might bring forth great whales, and every living creature that moveth, which the waters were to bring forth abundantly after their kind, and every winged fowl after their kind. And the gods saw that they would be obeyed, and that their plan was good. Now finally then, turn to chapter 5, verse 12 and 13, and note the numbers. Chapter 5, verse 1 and 2. And thus we will finish, and he's talking now about what they were going to do and what they said they would do in the grand council. And thus we will finish the heavens and the earth and all the hosts of them. And the gods said among themselves on the seventh time, we will end our work which we have counseled, and we will rest on the seventh time from all our work which we have counseled. And the gods concluded upon the seventh time, because that on the seventh time they would finish their work. This is the planning stage, and this is the blueprint phase, which they, the gods, counseled among themselves to form and to sanctify. And thus were their decisions at the time they counseled among themselves to form the heavens and the earth. See, that's the grand council on Kolob. And the gods came down and formed these, the generations of the heavens and the earth, when they were formed in the day that the gods formed the heavens, according to all which they had said concerning every plant. See, this is the actual implementation of it. Which they had said concerning every plant in the field before it was in the earth, and every herb of the field before it grew, for the gods had not caused it to rain upon the earth, and so forth. See? So Abraham then gives us an interesting account of the creation. Because of his unique experience of being taken back in vision and seeing himself and the noble and great ones, and that he was part of them, and then seeing the grand council as they sat there in Kolob, to create, as Yoda Smith said, the worlds that were created at the time. Let me give you the statement itself by the prophet Yoda Smith, where he talks to this, and here we are. It says, the head god called together the gods and sat in grand council. Now he calls the head god the father of the gods. So who's the head god? The man of holiness, right? And who were the gods in the grand council? The noble and great ones. At that point, Jesus, for example, was still an unembodied spirit, see? This is page 348 and 349. Okay, the head god called together the gods and sat in grand council to bring forth the world. The gods, the grand counselors, sat at the head in yonder heavens and contemplated the creation of the worlds, plural, W-O-R-L-D-S, of the worlds which were created at the time. You see that? Now you've got to put this whole creation picture, as Abraham gives it, into the context of all Christ's creations rather than just in the context of this earth. And you have to do that, for example, with the war in heaven. And you have to do that with the fall of Lucifer, if you're going to see the picture as the Abraham material enables us to see it, see?
You need to put it in that context and set it there. So that the earth then is created within that setting, and it's created then under the program of Kolob time. It's not created under the Kolob of the solar system in which it now exists. That's another ball game that was initiated at the time of the fall. When it was created, it was near Kolob. And as Abraham, for example, here in the fifth chapter of Abraham, recounts the story of placing life in the garden. He took the man and put him in the garden, verse 11. The gods commanded the man, saying, of every tree thou mayest eat freely, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil thou shalt not eat, for in the time, and he uses that phrase, in the time that thou eatest thereof, thou shalt surely die. And then Abraham makes this clarification. He says, now I, Abraham, saw that it was after the Lord's time, which was after the time of Kolob. For as yet the gods had not appointed unto Adam his reckoning. You see that? Now when you go to the creation then, you go to the Kolob system. And you go to an order of things where there is an organization of light and of power. And the gods, under the direction of the man of holiness, with Christ as the only begotten, as their executive head, then go down and say, we will take of these materials, and these are fragments of other worlds, as Joseph Smith would put it, and we will make an earth whereupon these may dwell. Now that's the picture, see, and that's focusing it on us, but the bigger picture is that they're involved then with the creation of worlds. Now let me get into another area here that's interesting and fascinating, and that comes directly from the Abrahamic material. As I've said, W.W. Phelps was probably the closest associated with the prophet Joseph Smith of any man in the translation of these materials. On date of December the 25th, 1844, this is just a few months after the martyrdom, he wrote a letter to Joseph Smith's brother, William Smith. It was published in the January issue of the Times and Seasons, 1845. In the course of that letter, he says this, when the house of Israel begins to come into the glorious mysteries of the kingdom, and find that Jesus Christ, whose goings forth, as the prophet said, have been from of old, from eternity. And that eternity, according to the records found in the catacombs of Egypt. Now this is some more of the Abrahamic material that Phelps was aware of. And that didn't get into the book here. And that eternity, according to the records found in the catacombs of Egypt, has been going on in this system. And then he puts parenthetically, that is in parentheses, not this world, in this system, almost 2,555,000,000 of years. And to know that at the same time that deists, geologists, others are trying to prove that matter must have existed for hundreds and thousands of years. Now that's an interesting statement. I've known that statement, I don't know how many years. 40, 50 years or so in my life, see? Maybe not that long, but at least 30 or 40. And pondered on it. Just pondered on it. Now, what does that mean? And I wasn't particularly pondering on it at the time, but I had a beautiful experience. Well, the Lord just opened that picture, and wow, it was one of those wow days that just really, wow, 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 ooh. And just over. And then within 2 weeks, 2 or 3 weeks, there were literally sources walked into my office that I didn't look for, and that others just somehow just, hey, I don't know what this means, Andrus. Here it is. What do you think about it, you see? And one of those sources is the following. comes from the historical department of the church, and I didn't go there and get it. It walked into my office. But it's an interesting report by Lorenzo Snow. He says this, I remember once being in the office in Nauvoo where the prophet Joseph Smith and some other brethren got to talking about the length of an eternity. Now, I call eternity in this sense a finite eternity because it has a beginning and has an end, okay? But it's assigned the word eternity. As Phelps says, eternity has been going on in this system almost 2,555,000,000 of years, see? Now, it had a beginning then, see? And possibly then an end, see? And so you're talking about what we call eternity, but you have to add the word finite in order to see, to get the focus that you need. All right, he says, we were in the office where Joseph the prophet and some other brethren were talking about the length of an eternity. One of the brethren, and this had to be Phelps, one of the brethren, when they dedicated the Nauvoo temple, this was after the saints had left Nauvoo, they, in the ceremony of dedication, they had a little time lapse. And something happened where they kind of stopped the procedure, and up jumps Phelps. And the record says, up jumps Phelps. And he talked to them about an eternity. Now, he didn't say there's nothing more in the report on it, but Phelps was up there putting his 2 cents worth in the dedication of the Nauvoo temple. But he says, one of the brethren, possibly Phelps, went to work and managed to get the number of years that composed an eternity. President Smith said that was correct. So you have the prophet sanctioning that, see? President Smith said it was correct. The number of years was vast and can scarcely be counted. Eternities have a beginning and an end. One eternity commences, and that has an end, and so on. Eternities upon eternities. Now, can you begin to get the picture? Let me clarify a little further. An eternity begins with the birth of the firstborn. It moves forward as the firstborn becomes the only begotten, in the sense of the divine nature, and becomes the agent of creation, first of spirit worlds, on which spirit children are placed, and where the first estate takes place. A lot of times we get the idea that the first estate took place in the Father's backyard, and the war in heaven took place there, and we just tore up the furniture and beat each other with whatever was available in that struggle, see? Now, Parley P. Pratt, in his Key to Theology, which is one of the few books the church officially publishes, makes the statement that when we were born as spirits, we were nurtured for a time in the immediate environs of the Father. And then we were transplanted on spirit worlds. And it's there where we had our first estate. And it's there where the furniture got torn up. It's there where the war in heaven took place, see? Now, an eternity begins with the birth of a firstborn. It progresses then as spirit worlds are created, as they are populated by the Father's spirit children born of celestial beings. And it moves on then when you have a final examination of the first estate, and where the war in heaven takes place. And then those that pass muster there and keep their first estate then are organized. And then you have to get together on Kolob in order to get things moving. And so the prophet Joseph Smith, as he puts the whole of section 76 in poetry form, and I want to get to that a little later, but among other things he's talking about, he says, from the council in Kolob to time on the earth. So he's referring back to that council that was held way back when, see? And you get together and you concoct the plan to create the worlds physically now that were created at the time, see? And then you have a ministry of Christ to those worlds that he creates. And that ministry moves forward then from one to the other. And I want to get into that a little from section 88 of the Doctrine and Covenants. And finally then, you come to the redemptive earth where Christ makes his atonement that reaches back in time and that finally then consummates this whole thing in the sense of foundation and preparation. And then you've got the great drama of the last days and the last dispensation and all of that that's still a part of the glorious picture of the latter-day picture that's far bigger than what we sometimes think, see? And when that is finally wound up and all things then are gathered together into one eternal dispensation in this eternity, not just this earth, but in this eternity, then and glorified, some worlds to a celestial, some to a terrestrial, some to a telestial state, see, then the whole thing is consecrated to the Father. And the prophet Joseph Smith, in talking about that, here in the great King Follett address, beginning here on page about 347, he says this. Now, what did Jesus do? Why, I do the things I saw my Father do when worlds came rolling into existence. My Father worked out his kingdom with fear and trembling, and I must do the same. And when I get my kingdom, now what is his kingdom? It's his eternity. You see that? When I get my kingdom, I shall present it to my Father, so that he may obtain kingdom upon kingdom, and it will exalt him in glory. He will then take a higher exaltation, and I will take his place. Now Christ then will cease to function as the Son, and he'll come up to the of Elohim, and he'll function in the role of the Father. And I will take his place, and thereby become exalted myself. So that Jesus treads in the tracks of his Father, inherits what the Father did before, and God is thus glorified and exalted in the salvation and exaltation of his children. Now you see that picture? And when that whole scenario was over with, and Christ then ceases to act in the role of the Son and the Only Begotten and all that, and is exalted and begins to act in the role of the Father, then where do you go from there? Where does the Father go from there? Where does Christ go from there? Where do those then who become joint heirs through him go? Where do things go in eternity from there? Well, the Father begets another firstborn who becomes another Only Begotten. You see that? And he gets another eternity in here. Jesus then begets a firstborn. And he gets another eternity in here. And those who have met the challenge, and it's a severe one, who receive the keys of endless life and are exalted then to be joint heirs through Christ in the full power of that term, will have power to do everything that Jesus can do and that the Father can do. And they will stand at the head of a new eternity of their own. And the ballgame will go on. Now, that is the concept that Joseph Smith unfolds from the Abrahamic material. And that idea, for example, is found through all early LDS literature. John Taylor, for example, the next month after this article came out by Phelps, this letter of Phelps to William Smith, John Taylor, as editor of the Times and Seasons, wrote of the Godhead, of the Father and the Son and the Holy Ghost. He says, they constitute the first presidency of this system or this eternity. Okay? Here's Eliza R. Snow, and this is another one that walked into my office. And that's a beautiful one. It shows that she understood the doctrine. She's speaking of the prophet Joseph, and she says, though his expansive mind grasped the great plan of salvation and solved the mystic problems of man's destiny, though he had in his possession keys that unlocked the past and the future with its succession of eternities, in his devotion he was as humble as a little child. Here's Brigham Young, the prophet's most ardent disciple. He spoke of the eternities that have been, that are, and that will be. Said he, no true philosopher can count the millions of eternities yet to be made. We shall learn in all time and in all eternities. When I got the scriptural program on my computer. Don't use it really very much. But in this instance, I put the word eternity on the program and pulled up everything that it had to say. And it was an interesting experience. I got all this stuff. All deals with eternity. Let me just read you one or two of them. Brigham Young. There is no being in all the eternities but what is governed by law. Again, he says, the power of the devil and the power of death are also from eternity to eternity. These two powers have ever existed and always will exist in all the eternities that are yet to come. Another one, I want to present salvation. I preach comparatively but little about the eternities of God's and their wonderful works in eternity, and do not tell who first made them and so forth. So he's got a few more things up his sleeve there. Here's a statement by Joseph F. Smith. He says, the eternities that lie before us, he refers to the eternity, and another one, in the never-ending eternities of our Father in heaven. This is President Joseph F. in his book, Gospel Doctrine. Here's another one. Speaks throughout all the eternities that will come. Here's one in the Articles of Faith. I was particularly happy about that one. The Articles of Faith, Talmage put it there. And it says, for example, we have seen further that the belief of this people carries them forward ever beyond the bounds of knowledge thus far revealed. See, he's got an ongoing thing. Let's get in and understand the program. He said, even beyond the bounds of knowledge thus far revealed, and teaches them to look with unwavering confidence for other revelations, truth yet to be added, glories grander and grander than have yet been made known, eternities of power and dominion and progress beyond the mind of man to conceive or the soul to contain. See, can you catch that picture? Now, it's in that context, and this is where the book of Abraham comes in and makes this tremendous contribution. And it's important in this sense. It gives a beginning and an end to things. I've heard even people on the religion faculty, I don't mean to be critical, but it's rather trite, who say that because the scriptures indicate the expansive creation of Christ, that he even created the world on which the Father had mortality. And he redeemed the world on which the Father had mortality. Now, I don't know quite how they came up with that one, see. But what I'm saying is now that this doctrine of eternity puts a beginning and an end to a certain order of things. And then it moves on, and then it expands onwardly. For example, now, let me turn, for instance, to section 88 of the Doctrine and Covenants. In section 88, the Lord gives us... Are we about out of time? Wow, tell me. Okay, section 88. We're gonna have to crowd this one. I gotta get this one over. Beginning with verse 51, the Lord is here speaking now of the cosmic picture, the worlds and so forth that he has created. And he gives us this in the form of a parable. And he talks about 12 fields, each field representing an earth. Now, his creations, Christ's creations, go far beyond the number of 12, believe me. Read Abraham's vision of where Jehovah put his hands on his eyes and showed him, and he couldn't see the end thereof, see? They go beyond that. But let's begin here reading in verse 51. Behold, I will liken these kingdoms to a man having a field, and he sent forth his servants into the field to dig in the field. And he said unto the first, go ye and labor in the field, and in the first hour I will come unto you, and ye shall behold the joy of my countenance. And he said unto the second, go ye also into the field, and in the second hour I will visit you with the joy of my countenance. And also unto the third, saying, I will visit you, and unto the fourth, and so on to the twelfth. Now each of these fields represents a world in this parabolic expression. And he says, and the Lord of the field went unto the first in the first hour, and carried with him all that hour, and he was made glad by the light and countenance of his Lord. And then he withdrew from the first that he might visit the second. And Orson Pratt makes an important clarification there. To withdraw means that these earths are in a mortal state. If they were celestial, you wouldn't be withdrawing from celestial presence because you're there, see? And so he suggests then that the word withdraw means, and that's also consistent with what he's later said, it indicates that they are in mortal state and in need of redemptive power, and Christ visits them in their mortal state. And he says in the second only, he withdrew from them from the first, and they might visit the second, and the third, and the fourth, and so on into the 12th. And thus they all receive the light and countenance of their Lord, every man in his hour, in his time, and in his season, beginning at the first, and so on to the last. Then note, there's two other actions. And from the last to the first. And from the first to the last. Now there's three actions there. Every man in his own order until his hour was finished, even according as his Lord had commanded him, that his Lord might be glorified in him, and he in his Lord. Now that makes it clear then that you're dealing then with worlds in the fallen state, and as they are created, then one by one, and in proper organization and order, tandem order, then Christ ministers to them. Now they don't have a resurrection because he hasn't broken the bands of death. And he's not crucified on them, on any of them, but he does go to them as Jehovah, as their Lord and their God. And he ushers in the millennium. And he can give the blessings of the gospel in part to them. He can give them the remission of sins, because as I read from the Abrahamic material, three persons made a covenant. God the Redeemer was Christ, and he made a covenant. And what was the nature of his covenant? He signed a promissory note that he would redeem all the worlds that the Father had placed into his power. See? And on that basis, then, he could draw benefits on the basis of his signature. He could draw benefits from the atonement before it was made. But there were some things that couldn't be done. He could draw benefits in giving the remission of sins. He could draw benefits in giving the gift of the Holy Ghost. He could draw benefits in giving the holy order and the program of the temple and all of that, see? He could draw those benefits. And he could draw benefits that would finally bring people up to a state of translation like Enoch did several thousand years before Christ came, see? And so as Jesus then visited these worlds, one after another, and established his kingdom, they couldn't be resurrected, but they could come up to the standard where they could be translated. And so portions are translated. And then the Lord moves on to the next world, and he visits it, and he visits the next one, and the next one, and the next one, until he gets to the redemptive earth. And on the redemptive earth, then, he makes the atonement. And that atonement then covers all the creations that he has made. Section 76 of the Doctrine and Covenants, the Lord, for example, makes this statement, or the prophet does, quoting a voice from heaven. Again, after the many testimonies that we have given, this is the testimony last of all, but we saw him. We heard the voice bearing record that he is the only begotten of the Father, that by him, Christ, and through him, Christ, and of him, Christ, the worlds are and were created, and the inhabitants thereof, all those worlds, are begotten sons and daughters unto God. Now, that's not talking about spirit birth. Here's Joseph Smith's version of that one in his classic poetic treatment, where he puts the whole of section 76 in poetry form. And now after all the proofs have been seen, and I heard a great voice bearing record from heaven, he is the Savior and only begotten of God. By him, of him, and through him, the worlds were all made, even all that career in the heavens so broad, whose inhabitants too, from the first to the last,
are saved by the very same Savior as ours, and of course are begotten God's daughters and sons by the very same truths and the very same powers. Now what does that say? It says that the power of the atonement reaches back, does it not? So as you come to the redemptive earth then, and Christ makes the atonement, it extends back. Another portion on section 76, maybe I better hit it, even though the time is gone. Verse 40 and verse 41. This is the gospel, the glad tidings which the voice out of heaven bore record, that he came into the world, even Jesus Christ, to be crucified for the world, and to bear the sins of the world, and to sanctify the world, and to cleanse it from all righteousness. Now read unrighteousness, rather. Now read verse 42. That through him all might be saved whom the Father had put into his power and made by him. What did Christ redeem? All those whom the Father had put into his power and made by him. What does the poetic version say? That he came in the world in the middle of time to lay down his life for his friends and his foes, and bear away sin as a mission of love, and sanctify earth for a blessed repose. 'Tis decreed he'll save all the works of his hands and sanctify them by his own precious blood, and purify earth for the Sabbath of rest by the agent of fire as it was by the flood. The Savior will save all his Father did give, even all that he gave in the regions abroad. Save the sons of perdition, they're lost, ever lost, and can never return to the presence of God. Now, Christ came and made the atonement to do what? To redeem all the worlds which the Father made by him. You see that picture? Now, in that process, he starts then from the first, and he ministers from the first to the last. And on the last, he makes the infinite atonement and redeems the whole. And then this last redemptive earth, as it moves into the millennial period, and we'll get a little more on that because I want to pick the theme up a little later, then is involved in a cosmic plan and a cosmic picture. And it becomes exalted so that the glory then centers in it because of it being the redemptive earth in Christ here. And when you get the fullness of glory finally centered in it, then there is an extension of that glory from the last to the first. And that's the second action of the three. The first to the last, and the last. And then there is a sealing of all those worlds to this world and its presiding authorities. And this sealing from the first to the last to make an eternal dispensation of the fullness of times. After which our dispensation of the fullness of times is patterned, you see, where all things then are gathered in and centered. And then the whole of that is given to Christ, and he consecrates it to the Father to terminate this eternity and then to move on. Now, can you see that picture? I'm going to have to break it off here. We'll get back to the rest in the next thrilling episode. But thanks for your patience. I just regret that I can't get this out more intelligently and clearly so that we can cover more ground, because there's so much to be revealed and to be discussed. Well, thank you, and we'll give you, what, 10 minutes present? Can we do that and do without a closing prayer? Fine. We'll see you. Thanks. I'm going to continue this thing on the creation for just a while, and before we move into the subject of the fall. We need to interject in what we've been talking about for the last hour or so, the picture of Moses. And I'd like to read then, enough at least, to put that in as a basis now for our discussion of the fall, to see the general picture as Moses gives it. Let me turn with you to Moses chapter 1, verse 31 and 41. That is 31 through 41. It says, "Behold the glory of God, of the Lord was upon Moses, so that Moses stood in the presence of God and talked with him face to face. And the Lord God said unto Moses, For mine own purpose have I made these things. Here is wisdom, and it remaineth in me. And by the word of my power have I created them, which is mine only begotten, who is full of grace and truth. And worlds without number have I created, and I also created them for mine own purpose. And by the Son I created them, which is mine only begotten. Now note, and the first man of all men have I called Adam, which is many. Now what's the context of that last statement? Is it this earth, or is it worlds without number? It's worlds without number. And in that context, the first man of all men on each of those worlds that are created and populated, the first of all men have I called Adam, which is many. You see that? So Adam then is a title denoting transition from the pre-fall to the fall state. You see that? And then in that context, still remaining there, he goes on and says, But only an account of this earth and the inhabitants thereof give I unto you. For behold, there are many worlds that have passed away. Now some people have a tendency to put an IE, passed away to glory and exaltation. You see that? It doesn't say that. And as you read it in historical context, it doesn't mean that. He's talking to Moses several hundred years before Christ made the atonement. There hadn't been any resurrection on any of these worlds that Christ created. Had there? The bands of death hadn't been broken. And so there have been many worlds that have passed away. They've been created and they've passed away. Now, I had added to that, and I don't just add it as personal opinion, but we talked about Enoch, for example, and his ministry to terrestrial bodies. There are two kinds of terrestrial bodies. There are translated terrestrial bodies, and there are resurrected terrestrial bodies. And when the Lord says, for example, to Enoch, as he does here in the teachings, page 170, Now this Enoch, God reserved to himself that he should not die at the time, was appointed to him in ministry unto terrestrial bodies. Now, given the context that's set by the idea of this eternity, that this eternity is Christ's creation, this eternity is his ball game. Can I put it that way? It's his program. And there aren't any resurrected terrestrial beings yet for Enoch to have any presidency over, unless he gets outside of the eternity and goes over and finds an eternity other by some other only begotten and says, Hey, I want to preside over your terrestrial planets. And that's inconsistent. You see that? All right, so the terrestrial worlds then over which he presides are terrestrial bodies out of this eternity. And where do they come from? Well, when Christ ministered to each of these worlds, and they enjoyed the joy of his countenance, and he implemented his gospel program in fullness among them to the extent that it could then be implemented. Then they came up not only to fullness of priesthood, they came up to the powers of translation, many of them, and they were translated. And then as a part of the whole scenario, the whole great cosmic scenario, then on the redemptive earth, this great and noble personality, this humble lad, this stammering soul, at least he called himself that, who built Zion and got them into the state of translation, is then given keys over the terrestrial bodies of this eternity, so that it ties all of those into this world, this redemptive earth. You see that? Now, there's a statement by the prophet Joseph Smith. I didn't bring the source with it, and I should have. I ran off half-cocked on a few things. I've had to borrow the president's neckties last night and tonight, I'm going to run off again because he's got some pretty good ties. But there's a statement by the prophet where he talks about the ministry of Christ after the resurrection. Now, we know that he ministered to the Nephites here. We know that he went to minister among the 10 tribes, and I don't believe that was a tracting spree through Northern Europe. He ministered to them as a body. They're the outcasts of Israel, those who've been cast out, not those who are scattered. And the prophet says that he also ministered to resurrected and translated bodies. Okay? He ministered to resurrected and translated. Now, resurrected ones be those who had died and were with him in the resurrection, or shortly thereafter. Translated bodies would be those then who are sitting on these other worlds that Enoch has the keys of presidency over. And so he goes there, and they have a glorious meeting. And what do they say? Well, I haven't read the records, but I think I know basically what they said, at least in one basic and important point. They said, look, brethren, you're in a translated state. Now, you could have the option of moving on through and becoming resurrected, because the gate of resurrection is open. But I want you to ponder on something. Besides there not being any resurrection, there is no work for the dead that's able to be done until Christ makes the atonement. Baptism for the dead began with the resurrection. You see that? The endowments for the dead require the resurrection of Christ. That program is resurrection program, if I can put it that way. And as Jesus ministered then to these worlds, and they had their millennial period, there had been those then who had died only having part of the gospel. There had been those, I suspect, then who died in a state of apostasy and didn't have the gospel. And all of that, they were successive dispensations like we've had on this earth, see. At least that seems to be a logical conclusion. And then Christ ministers to them. And there are some who are translated. And then Enoch is given the keys of presidency over them. Now, and then after the resurrection, Christ has a great meeting on Kola with resurrected and translated bodies. And he reminds them now that there's been no redemption for the dead, and that Enoch holds the keys, and that they can do temple work as translated beings, because they're still mortal. They're still mortal. And they can do work as translated beings. And that they have a great work that needs to be done in order for their whole worlds then to finally be given justice and equity and the blessings of the gospel according to the desires and interests of each person, for all that to be given then to the people of their respective spheres, see. And then the Lord puts his arm around Enoch and says, now I've given to Enoch the keys of priesthood. Now let's get the job done. Now that, my brothers and sisters, is why salvation for the dead is the greatest work. You ever thought of it in that light? That's why salvation is the greatest work, see. And that ties that whole thing in with this earth, this redemptive earth. And that will tie that whole thing in with this dispensation and place that whole ballgame under Joseph the prophet. It's little wonder he would say, I would to God, brethren, I could tell you who I am. I would to God I could tell you what I know. You see that? Now there's a bigger picture there, see? Why does one earth then shall pass away, and the inhabitants thereof? Another shall come. And he says, there are many that now stand. Innumerable are they in demand, but all things are numbered unto me, for they are mine, and I know them. I'm reading back here in the book of Moses, verse 36 now. And it came to pass that Moses spake unto the Lord, saying, be merciful unto thy servant, O God, and tell me concerning this earth and the inhabitants thereof, and also the heavens, and then thy servant will be content. And the Lord God spake unto Moses, saying, the heavens, they are many, and they cannot be numbered unto man, but they are numbered unto me, for they are man. And as one earth shall pass away, and no IE to exaltation to it, as one earth shall pass away, and the heavens thereof, that is the atmospheric heavens, even so shall another come. and there is no end to my works, neither to my words. And in that context, then he makes this great statement, for behold, this is my work and my glory, to bring to pass the immortality and eternal life of man. See, you're not talking merely about this earth. It's talking about the cosmic picture. You see that? It's talking about that great cosmic picture. And I think it's with this kind of inspiration, for example, that Marion G. Romney makes this statement. It's in the Old Improvement Era, November of 68. He's quoted these worlds, this scripture, world without number have I created. I created for mine own purpose. And then he says this. From this and other scriptures, we learn that representing the Father and serving his purpose to bring to pass the immortality and eternal life of man, and he's put it in the cosmic context, Jesus Christ, in the sense of being its creator and redeemer, is the Lord of the whole universe. Now, we say that is his eternity, okay? Except for his earthly ministry accomplished on this earth, his service and his relationship to other worlds and their inhabitants are the same as his service and relationship to this earth and its inhabitants. So what did Jesus do then to these other worlds except for the atonement? He ministered to them. You see that? Is that what the parable in section 88 says? And does that mad meaning then from the first to the last? And then the last being the redemptive earth, and then you move the glory, that's the full glory, then from the last to the first. Then you tie them all in to make one eternal dispensation of the fullness of times, centered in Christ, which he now then consecrates to the Father. See? You see that beautiful picture now? To me, that gives meaning. That gives a beginning. That gives an end. And that gives an onward program that just rolls to where? I don't know. You see that? And it gives just a solid sense of understanding and comprehension where you go then from eternity to eternity, and how many there are yet to be made. Well, I'll tell you, 450 billion plus. I just put a big emphasis on that word plus. Ad infinitum. Okay? Now, as we talk about the creation, and we'll move this then into the picture of the fall, Moses uses the same format that Abraham uses. There's this difference. Abraham's is an account of the creation, of the blueprint plus the creation. Moses' account is an account of the creation after the fact. Where the Lord merely says, Moses, this is what I did. I did, and it was so. And I did this, and it was so. Now, the when of the "and it was so" is another question, see. He merely says, "and it was so." And he doesn't clarify the details in that sense. But he moves through the same sequence of things. And in the creation, the first 6 days, and this is Abraham chapter 4, and Moses chapter 3. Abraham 4 and Moses 2. They're talking about the creation of this physical earth. And then Abraham chapter 5 and Moses chapter 3 is the account of the seventh day's activities. And on that seventh day, they sanctified the earth, and Moses then makes the clarification that's in this context now is meaningful. Let's start with verse 4, for example. After having said that they sanctified the earth, in other words, brought it up then to a paradisiacal state, "And behold, I say unto you that these are the generations of the heavens and of the earth when they were created, in the day that I, the Lord God, made the heavens and the earth, and every plant of the field before it was in the earth, and every herb before it grew. For I, the Lord God, created all things of which I have spoken spiritually before they were naturally upon the face of the earth." Now, that statement is not found in the book of Abraham. Why? Well, because Abraham prefaces the account of the creation, which is Abraham 4 and 5 with Abraham 3. And Abraham 3 is his great vision of the Kolob system. And it finally focuses on the intelligences that were organized and talks about the great and noble ones. And it's obvious this is the first estate, isn't it? This is the first, and you don't have to say I traded them all before, because that's inherent in the story, the account of Abraham. It's inherent within it, see? But Moses doesn't have Abraham chapter 3 as a preface. He just starts, in the beginning, God created the world. You see that? And then he moves on from there. And so he finds it necessary now to make two clarifications. Sometimes we only point out that he makes one. To make two clarifications. The first is that all forms of life had a pre-earth first estate existence. I, the Lord God, created all things of which I have spoken spiritually before they were naturally upon the face of the earth, for I, the Lord God, had not caused it to rain upon the earth. And I, the Lord God, had created all the children of men, and this gets into the second clarification, and not yet a man to till the ground. So after the first 6 days of creation, how much life was there on the earth? And the answer is none. The answer is none. Now that's the Abraham account. The Abraham account makes it very clear. For example, let me just take a minute here and get into that for a few minutes to make that point clear. In Abraham, the first day, then he talks about organizing the earth and bringing the materials together, and the earth is empty and desolate. The Moses account says it's without form and void. Joseph Smith says, if I can find that right here quick, in the translation, without form and void, it should read empty and desolate. So he didn't make that correction in the book of Moses. He didn't get there through the translation, through the inspired revision. And so that feature of the book of Moses then is deficient according to the prophet's statement. See? So it's empty and desolate, but the earth is brought together, it's inundated with water. On the second day, then, they tinkered with the lights. Now, the earth wasn't in the solar system that it's in now. And when they talk about the organization of lights, they're organizing things in preparation for the fall. You see that? And on the third day, the gods ordered, saying, let the waters under the earth be gathered together in one place, and let the earth come up dry. So for the first two days of creation, or the first two times, to use Abraham's terminology, the whole earth was inundated with water. And if you saw the earth, you would see just look out like a lake. It's covered over with water. The earth was born out of a watery womb. And it was baptized. And it's going to be cleansed with fire. And it's going to die. And it's going to be resurrected. You see that? The pattern and the program is basically the same. And when you see portrayals then of the earth, and it's not just covered with water, then that's some kind of a portrayal rather than the historic fact. Because the account of creation, both in Moses and Abraham, indicate that it's inundated with water until the third day. Now on the fourth day then, God's organized the lights in the expanse of the heavens. They come back then to this issue of let there be light, and light shone upon the earth from God's presence, and now they organize the lights. And then it goes on to say, and in the fifth day the gods said, let us prepare the waters to bring forth abundantly. And the gods prepared the waters. Now it doesn't say they put anything in it. They got the aquarium ready. You see that? They didn't put anything in it. Now when it comes to the sixth day, the gods prepared the earth to bring forth the living creatures after his kind, cattle and creeping things and beasts of the earth after their kind. And it was so even as they said. And the gods organized the earth to bring forth the beast after their kind. Didn't say put anything on there. He organized it to bring them forth. And cattle after their kind and everything that creepeth. And the gods took counsel among themselves and said, let us go down and form man in our image and after our likeness, and we will give them dominion over the fish of the sea. So the gods went down to organize man. Now, they didn't say they did it, that they went down here and got on terra firma and were ready to do it. You see that? And the gods said, we will bless them. And it's future tense. This is what we are going to do down the road. We will cause them to be fruitful. We will give them every herb, verse 19. And the fruit that shall grow. See, it's still future. It's not something that they've done or are doing. And to every beast of the field and to every fowl of the earth, we will give them life, and it's still future tense. And the God said, we will do everything that we have said and organized, and behold, they shall be very obedient. And that's prophetically speaking, at the time when we finally wake up to reality on this earth. And it came to pass that it was from the evening to the morning, they called night, and it was in the pass it from the morning, evening, they called day, and it was them, and they numbered the sixth time. Now, when did they put any life on earth in the first 6 days? And the answer is zilch. They didn't. You see that? And then Abraham goes on, and on the seventh day, he said, on the seventh time we will end our work. And so, then he goes on, God came down and formed these, the generations of the earth, according to all that they had said, for the gods had not caused it to rain upon the earth. And there was no, when they counseled to do them, and they had not formed man to till the ground. But there went up a mist from the earth and watered the whole face of the ground, and the gods formed man from the dust of the ground and took his spirit, that is man's spirit, and put it into him and breathed in his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul, and the gods planted the garden eastward in Eden, and so forth. And the gods took the man then and put him in the garden. Now that's where you get the creation of life, see? And then it goes on, and after talking about the creation of Mother Eve, a helpmeet for Adam, then it goes on and says that and out of the ground the gods formed every beast of the field and every fowl of the air and so forth. See? And that's all seventh-day stuff. Can you see that picture? Now, that's what it says in the book of Moses. Moses makes two clarifications. Number one, all forms of life of which he is speaking have been created in spirit form prior to the physical creation. And then he says, for there was not yet a man to till the ground, verse 5, for in heaven created I them, and there was not yet flesh upon the earth, neither in the water, neither in the air, at the beginning of the seventh day. He says, but the Lord spake, and there went up a mist from the earth, and watered the whole face of the ground, and the Lord God formed man from the dust of the ground, and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul, comma, and you need to let me put the punctuation in there, because it needs to be made very clear. God, they made man a living soul, comma, the first flesh upon the earth, the first man also. Nevertheless, all things which were created spiritually. And then he talks about the other forms of life, see. Now, what does the prophet Joseph Smith say, for example, when he turned to section 77 of the Doctrine and Covenants, verse 12, where the prophet is making certain clarifications concerning the book of Abraham, the book of Revelation, rather. And he says, what do we understand by the sounding of the trumpets mentioned in the 8th chapter of Revelation? Answer, we are to understand, and note this, that as God made the world in 6 days, and on the seventh day he finished his work, and sanctified it, and also formed man out of the dust of the earth. All right, now, what has he done? What did he do the first 6 days? How many of us can read English? What did he do? As God made the world in 6 days, and on the seventh day, what day? The seventh day, he finished his work and sanctified it, brought it to a pair of disciples, say, and also formed man out of the dust of the earth. When was man formed? Now, is that really it? That's what it's saying, is it not? Now, he says, he uses that as a comparison to the millennial state. He says, even so, in the beginning of the 7,000 years, will the Lord God sanctify the earth and complete the salvation of man and judge all things and redeem all things except that which he hath put into his power? And so forth, see. Now, a lot of people think that Christ is going to come at the opening of the seventh seal. And then they put that at the year 2000, April 6th. And they say that's the second coming of Christ. That's not what the prophet Joseph is saying. He's saying that as God made the world in 6 days, and there wasn't any life on it at the end of the 6 days, and in the seventh day he sanctified it and did a whole work of importance that pertains to the Sabbath, placing life upon the earth, see? Man as the first flesh. Like that, in similar way then, at the beginning of the 7,000 years, at the beginning of the 7,000 years, then he's going to do a work. He's going to sanctify the earth. And he's going to complete the salvation of man. And he's going to judge all things. And shall redeem all things, except that which he has put in his own power. And he's going to seal all things at the end of all things. Now the end of all things is Christ. And all that great work. And that's the work then of the 144,000. And that's the work that's consummated in Christ coming to his temple and the great Adam on Diomen scene. All of that after the opening of the seventh seal. And it's part of that great work then of the seventh day to sanctify the earth and to prepare it for Christ's glory and his coming in his power in the heavens. And he makes the two actions then of creation and the actions of second coming like each other. You see that? Now, what does that say for the second coming? It says that there's going to be a great work done at the opening of the seventh seal. And it'll consummate in Christ's second coming. And it'll be a work of cleansing the earth and of sanctifying the earth, of getting rid of the wicked, and of elevating the righteous then to his glory and to his power, and endow them with his glory, and get them ready and seal all things to the end of all things. And this is the great council of Adam on Diomen, see? And this is his coming to his temple to put the capstone on the holy order and all of that, see? And this then is seventh day stuff. This is millennial stuff. This is the beginning of the 7,000 years, see? So when someone jumps up and says, Adam on Diomen is going to take place in 1993, someone got that out in print somewhere. And then someone else jumped up in 1894 and says the same thing, see? They simply don't know the picture. There's no comprehension of the ball game, let alone reason to make those kinds of conclusions. See? Well, that's the story then of creation. And as we see that picture then, the earth is prepared, it's sanctified, and then the Lord plants a garden eastward in Eden. Now, you folks are farmers enough to know how you plant a garden. You get yourself some seeds, don't you? And then you dig a little hole and put a fish in it. I don't know about that fish in this instance. But you get the fertilizer there, and you get the thing growing. All right, so they planted a garden. Where did they get the seeds?